Hello.
How are you?
I'm good. How are you? Are you Danny?
I'm Danny. How are you? What's your name?
Tara Lee.
Hey, how are you? Sorry about the other link.
What's that?
Sorry about the other URL.
Oh, that's fine. That's totally fine.
Well, welcome to the Partially Examined Life After Show.
Thank you.
I'm pretty excited about it. I'm excited to be doing it. I'm a little out of it because I was in the ER till pretty late last night.
Oh, no.
Yeah, I was involved in a three-car collision. I was in the passenger seat.
Oh my god.
But yeah, I'm relatively okay. I just have a really bad case of whiplash.
Oh.
So I'm not trying to gain sympathy points, but bear with me is all I'm saying. I'm being a trooper and going forward, but I'm in a bit of pain and on some painkillers. So anyway, so how are you? Where are you listening from?
I'm listening from Portland, Oregon.
Awesome, Portland, such a cool place. How do you like it there? Is that why you're knitting? Because you're from Portland?
No, I'm knitting because I have this project that I started in November and I still haven't finished it. But I like Portland okay. It's really expensive. It's a lot more expensive than I was expecting, and it's replete with hipsters, which is a little bit of a challenge sometimes in terms of patient. But it's okay.
Yeah.
I'm from Seattle originally, so it's not that different.
These places always start out affordable and then get so expensive. That's what happens, you know.
Yeah.
That's the trick of it. I see Seth joined us also. Hey, Seth.
Hey, can you hear me?
I can.
I don't have an internal mic on this silly computer, so I have to put this giant thing in front of my face. So I apologize.
There isn't an image of you, actually.
Yeah, there will be. Hold on just a sec.
Okay.
Yeah,
so. Okay.
We can't wait to see you.
I thought this was in 30 minutes, so I'm grasping to get ready here.
I think we started 15 minutes or so, maybe a little more even late,
I had it on my calendar
early.
I had it on my calendar for 5 o'clock Central.
Oh, is it not 5 o'clock Central?
No, it's 4.
Oh, so we're early.
No, the email said 5 p.m. East Coast, 2 p.m. Pacific.
Oh.
But I don't know. I also noticed that not a lot of other people are here, so I don't know if I'm the only one who read the email.
You may have confused people. It confused us, obviously, so, I mean, maybe other people will start joining in soon also.
Yeah.
But like I said, I'm generally confused today.
Why is that?
I was in a car accident on Friday.
Oh, no.
And my head has been spinning ever since. I got a serious whiplash, and I was in the ER last night till 3 a.m.
Oh.
So I'm on pain meds and stuff now. So I'm pushing through, but I'm not all there. I'm giving you the heads up, but that's okay. That's okay. I think, you know, not all there. You might get some interesting stuff.
Well, I stand ready to grab the baton.
Awesome. I was still looking forward to this. I'm like, I don't care. I don't care how bad this accident is. I'm not missing this Partially Examined Life hangout. Which is the truth. I really am excited to be doing this.
Cool. I'm trying to figure out how to turn my camera on. For some reason, it's... I wonder if I disabled it somewhere.
I know at the top of my screen, there's a couple of buttons. I'm assuming you know about these, but there's a couple of buttons, one of which is like turn camera off and one is mute.
Yeah, so I have it turned on according to Google, but it's still not showing anything. So I think there must be something else somewhere in my system that's...
Yeah.
What is it called? The control panel.
So what's the project that you're knitting?
It's going to be a cowl. It's going to be something that, you know, goes around your neck a couple of times, but it's all one piece. Like, I'll knit the two ends together.
So you're saying you're not a hipster, right?
It's a good question. A friend of mine has been debating this for years, but she has come to the conclusion that because I am a regular churchgoer and drink bad coffee, that I am not a hipster.
But that might be so ironic that it is hipster.
I have surpassed even the hipsters. Yeah, that's true. That's true, actually.
Yeah.
I don't know.
That might be like the next phase for all of them. Like, yeah, man, I don't know. I'm going to church. I could see it going that way.
I could see it going that way, too. I think the thing is, though, I don't know that hipsters are capable of being earnest. I think that's, like, the central thing to being a hipster, and I'm really painfully earnest. So I feel like that insulates me from accusations of hipsterdom, but I don't know.
Interesting point. I'll have to think that one over. I see where you're coming from, though. Did you see the movie While We're Young?
No, I kind of wanted to see it. It looked a little bit interesting.
I liked it a lot. I think it kind of spoke to your sentiments about hipsters. So.
Oh, really? Yeah. Like the younger couple, they looked very hipsterish to me.
Yeah, they're the hipster ones who lack the earnest that you're referring to. Seth, how's your camera thing going, by the way?
Well, by all accounts, it should be working. And I'm looking in the settings right now. It's active and enabled in my system. And it's showing as selected in Google. What are these other little guys on the left-hand side? Chat, screen share, Q&A, capture, control room. What's that? Okay.
I wish I knew more about technology, not just for this instance, but in general.
Yeah, the irony that I can't figure this out, since I'm supposed to be the one who does know about technology, is not lost on me. Well, let's see. I wonder how else could I test it. Let me open Skype real quick and see if it shows up in Skype.
I'm wondering if I should get started with the conversation on the episode in the meantime, or should we... I mean, we're all kind of chilling right now anyway. Should we just wait until you're up and running? What do you think?
We can get started with the conversation if you like. I'll either figure this out or I won't, but it's not critical to...
not critical to talking?
I don't think so.
Because I feel like you have at least another few minutes left on the knitting before that's complete.
I have several, actually. Yeah. Although I can knit while we talk. But yes, I have quite a while on this knitting, actually.
It's nice to see something being made in America.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
It's not cost efficient, but it's very fun.
Yeah. So we're talking about episode 114, Schopenhauer. Mm-hmm. And where do we start? Seth, where do people usually start? What do you think of the episode?
I enjoyed it a lot. I'll be the one lone speaking person for everyone else. I enjoyed it quite a bit. There were some terminology things that sort of came up for me as I was listening to it. I remember, I think it was Mark, although it could have been somebody else, used a term, the for itself, and I was not totally clear on what that referred to. I think I roughly understand Kant's thing in itself, that concept. Mm-hmm. That I think I generally get that, but the for itself was not something that I understood. And then I was also just sort of generally curious about the term the will. I was partially curious what the German is for it, just because it seems like such an odd word. As I was listening to it, you know, obviously being used over and over again, the more I listened to it, the more it just sounded like will feels like it's describing something so desire-based, which feels so particular and human. Feels like it's not a great word to capture what Schopenhauer is talking about, but that word sort of threw me, and I was sort of curious what the German was, if anybody knows.
Seth, were you trying to say something? Did we lose him?
I don't know. His picture is still showing up down there, but he's not speaking.
Seth? Well, I can tell you that I don't know what those terminologies meant. I listened to the episode twice because it was a lot for me to take in. I'm still trying to figure out exactly what I retained from it, but I thought it was a very fascinating conversation. I don't know German. You're asking a Jew. So,
well, that's funny because I'm German, so I should know.
Yeah. I think Seth is back. I don't. Are you back, Seth?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes.
We hear you, yeah.
Okay, sorry. I don't. Maybe my connection's bad or something. So, to answer your first question, I'm sorry if I'm interrupting, but the German word is will or Wille.
Okay.
So the German title of the book is Die Welt als Wille und Vorstellung. Vorstellung is typically translated as representation, because that's the technical term for the appearance of a thing that we consume with our senses in the language of the time. And the German term will, I think, again, this is something that at the time Schopenhauer was writing would have meant something very specific, or would have suggested something very specific that it doesn't suggest now. I think now our reading of will is much colored much more by Nietzsche. So we think of will as this individual motive power that gets us to do things. Yeah. And in Schopenhauer's playing off of, I would say, Kant in this respect, where he's thinking of a faculty of will, just like Kant had there was the faculty of reason and a faculty of judgment. You can think will more of as a faculty, and that's what he's trying to turn on its head, so to speak, is to say that it's not part of the structure of consciousness that gives shape to the world, as Kant thought, but instead it's actually what underlies or what is behind all of the appearances in the world. He's basically saying will is actually Kant's thing in itself, whereas Kant thought that will was a faculty that brought that we used to contribute to our experience of the world to shape the world.
I thought it was pretty interesting. I mean, when they were talking about consciousness of the body, when you guys were talking about consciousness of the body, and whether or not the body itself has a certain consciousness to it. And how that tied in with what you were saying about will being a faculty, kind of taking these abstract concepts and trying to give them, I don't want to say physicality, but I mean, how would you put it?
Well, I'm trying to think of that's a big thing for me to tackle right off the bat. I think what I liked about Schopenhauer's approach, and I was very excited when I did the reading, and it didn't come across when we did the recording. I just, for whatever reason, wasn't able to kind of engage, which happens sometimes, so I wasn't able to articulate all the things that I had in my mind. But what I liked about Schopenhauer's approach is that he's using our embodiment as the starting point. And he's taking very seriously the idea that we are beings in the world, to use language that will come later. And he's saying we have to take seriously the fact that we have this experience of being embodied, and we have this experience simultaneously of being this...
being a body.
Being a unity. Being a unity of experience and consciousness, namely our past and projecting their future. And him saying, you know, we can see ourselves in these two different aspects, and by doing that, that becomes the start jumping off point to see other things as having those same two aspects. Because we can't assume that we're the only beings in the universe or in the world that are like this.
Yeah, it's interesting, you know, just how the past shapes the present. Just to expand on what you're saying, I often wonder about, like, you know, I'm going to now reference Adam Sandler's 50 First Dates, but, you know, you've seen the movie, I'm sure, right?
I have not, but...
Well, I think I have, yes.
Basically, Drew Barrymore, she experiences some kind of trauma that makes it so that every day she doesn't remember anything from her past, and every day is like a new start.
Oh! So every day, yeah. I saw that silently at a hospital while I was at a birth. I could not...
that's the funniest way to have watched Adam Sandler's 51st
Yeah, I definitely saw that, though.
Silently at a hospital at a birth.
Yep.
Cool. Well, so, I mean, that's definitely something that I think about a lot, and I was thinking about it while I was listening to this episode, is just, like, what if every day your consciousness was only based on that day? Like, who you are starts today. You know, I was talking to a friend of mine this week who feels that he's a bad person, and he's not a bad person, but, I mean, he's just got low self-esteem. And all the things that he thinks makes him a bad person are things from, like, a while ago. And I'm like, I could relate to that, because I used to be that same way. I used to think I was a bad person because I was upset. And when you actually sit down and analyze why you did those things when you were a teenager, and they're not even that bad things, and you realize, oh, I just have been beating myself up, and it's nothing to do with a good or bad person. First of all, I've come to the... I'm getting sidetracked, but I've come to the conclusion that there are no good or bad people. Everybody's neutral, and people do or don't do good or bad things in certain situations. They make good or bad decisions. And there are different aspects of people's personality and character that, you know, they need to work on. And in some respects, people are great. In some respects, they're not so great. There's no good or bad person. But I was talking to this friend of mine who is still convinced that he's a bad person because of things that he did years ago, which, by the way, in my opinion, weren't that bad. And I said, that person doesn't even really exist anymore. Yes, you are an evolution from that person. But that person was you as a teenager. This person is you as a 30-something-year-old. You're a different person now. And you have the decision to make, at this point in your life, what kind of person you are now. And you don't have to hang on to, you know, the 18-year-old version of yourself and what that person's decisions were. You could be your own person right now and going forward for maybe another 60 years. And every day you'll determine if you're a good or bad person. And you don't have to let the events of your past shape and dictate your present and future. So when I was listening to you guys discussing that, all that stuff was kind of coming to mind for me because, you know, you're talking about the consciousness of reflecting on, you know, the person's past, the present, and I wonder to what extent is that important even?
Well, I feel like on the one hand, like from a, I think there's even a friend of mine actually who I think definitely thinks along the lines that you're describing. She even once read somewhere that I can't remember what it is, but it's like, within 20 years or something, every cell in your body will have been completely replaced or something like that. Like, there is a certain point at which on a material level you are not made up of the same atoms that you were made up of at some point in the past. And I get the appeal of that, but I think that sort of denies the reality that we experience ourselves as a unity. I mean, it is strange to think of oneself as being, like, having continuity with one's childhood self. Like, it's a really trippy feeling to think of that person as being the you that you are now.
Right.
But you are shaped by, you are absolutely shaped by, and everyone is shaped by, and I, like, by those things that have happened to them in their past, and by their body, and the way people experience their body, and all of these things that are totally outside of your control. And I think, to me, that's something that we have to keep in mind when we're coming up with ideas of what we are. And it's not a reassuring feeling. It's a terrifying feeling. It means that your past will be carried with you into the future, and it means that things that are outside of your control will continue to shape you into the future. But I think that, I don't know, I feel like that unity is a part of who we are. And we...
You don't think you can compartmentalize your life into...
No. I mean, you can, and then you will be a broken human being.
Mm-hmm.
I think that you have to find a way to, like, integrate all of the various parts of yourself.
Your thoughts, Seth.
Well, I think it's interesting that you guys are taking this in that direction. Here's why. So I think, you know, Schopenhauer thought in a not insignificant way that he was doing metaphysics, and he is responding very directly to Kant. But he doesn't talk explicitly about identity. What he's talking, you know, when he uses that as kind of the foundation for what he's trying to do, meaning that fundamental experience that you're describing, Tara, of having this experience of ourselves as a unity, mm-hmm. is sui generis. It's that means of one of a kind, like not like anything else. It's not
after its own kind. Yeah.
Yeah. Right. So what he's saying is that the direct phenomenological experience, if you will, that you have of that is indicative of a much broader metaphysical structure that's at play in the world, where mm-hmm. I have this unity, and so I have to assume that you have this unity, mm-hmm. and I have to assume, which I think would lend credence to your point, which is it has to be something that we take for granted. And I think he would have real trouble with what Danny was saying, this idea that we are different people than we were. There has to be some retained measure of connection to that younger self. Even if you say, I've completely changed my beliefs and my ideas and I'm physically different and all those things, you still have to be able to look back on that person that was you and self-identify with it. Not distance yourself from it, because that would break up that fundamental experience.
Right. I wonder, you know, what role fate plays in all of it, and you know, to what extent are you responsible for everything that makes you that unity?
Yeah.
To what extent is it circumstantial as well? Because if the circumstances change, That's definitely an argument for, you know, the breaking up of, you know, this continuity, right?
I don't know quite how to bridge that. You know, because Schopenhauer doesn't address the idea so much across, kind of say, a lifetime. You know, he's talking about that experience being sort of paradigmatic of our experience as human beings. Mm-hmm. And maybe that's a weakness in the argument, you know, where he's doing what, of course, many, many male philosophers in the Western tradition have done, which is to generalize from their own experience to everybody else's. I honestly didn't push on it, I think, when I was reading, simply because I thought the move itself was interesting to make that jump and use that as the starting off point for this broader metaphysical discussion. But it's a valid criticism, mm-hmm. or at least questioning of that assumption.
Actually, I'm wondering, I don't know, I'm sort of curious, like, what a Schopenhauerian response would be, because I'm thinking about people, these are very different experiences as I understand them, but, like, I know that some people have really serious, like, I don't know if I'm using the appropriate technical term, but, like, dysphorias, where, like, they, I mean, or maybe amnesia would be an example, but, like, an accident or some kind of trauma will cause them to not perceive their body as their own or to not connect with their childhood self. And then I'm also thinking about transgender people who describe this experience of, like, seeing their body in a mirror and having this, like, really nightmarish, it sounds like, experience of not feeling like that body is a reflection of themselves, of how they see themselves in their mind. And I'm just sort of curious, like, what... because that seems like a disunified experience of oneself. And I'm curious... I don't know. I'm trying to decide if it is a disunified experience or not.
I wonder if that could be, you know, something to do with the will that he's talking about inside a person. Do you think that could be a possible explanation for, like, understanding what he, you know, the will inside a person would dictate that view of who they are inside?
I think that has to be part of it. You know, I think there's a couple of interesting things that are being brought out by what you guys are saying. You know, the first is if he's going to use his own experience as this unified self. And by the way, we can question whether you actually had that experience. We talk about it generally, but mm-hmm. I have no real connection to what I was like when I was 7 years old. Yeah. You know, memory is the only glue that we have that holds our past together. And memory, we know, is a very questionable organ, as it were.
Yeah.
But, you know, the burden's going to have to be on him to either justify the generalization from his own experience or to acknowledge that if people have other different kinds of experiences that don't give them the same starting point, that, that, you know, they may take it in a different direction, just like Tara just mentioned about people who have that different experience. Now, with respect to what you're talking about, Danny, with being the kind of disjointed nature and all that, mm-hmm. sorry, about the will being that thing. So remember that the project in the book is he's responding 100% to Kant, and we probably didn't tease that out enough in the episode. I fear it might be something we all took for granted, but Kant basically did something really awesome, right? Which was he solved skepticism about our experience in the world, or he thought he did, right? So very, very briefly, and I apologize if this is repetitive or unnecessary. If it is, just tell me to shut up. But you have this notion of idealism, where you know, all of our experience is just ideas in our head. We can't know the real world. We can't have a true epistemic connection to the real world, or at least not one that we can rely on. And that's how you get, on the one hand, Humean skepticism, where Hume just says, you know, there's no causality in the world, or we don't experience causality in the world. We just see the same thing happening over and over again, but we have no reason to believe that tomorrow it's going to happen the same way. And then you have Berkeley, who just said, every time we close our eyes, God reinvents the world for us, right? There's no anchor, there's no objects, there's nothing. Well, mm-hmm. Kant, that obviously didn't sit well with Kant, because Kant is trying to create a basis for doing science. He wants philosophy to explain why science mm-hmm. is a worthwhile undertaking. So he does this radical move where he basically proves that we experience, that as we get our experiences from the world, they don't come to us complete and whole and partitioned the way we have them. Instead, we contribute that to the experience of the world. So it's not like time, space and time and extension are things in the world so much as they're categories that we apply, and number, color, all of these things are particular to our experience. And so sense data or impressions that we get from the world are this mass of just what he calls the manifold of intuition. It just is like all you get is bombarded with data. Your eyes and your ears and your nose and your skin just absorbs information. And your brain contributes all the stuff that gives it sense. Your brain is the one that tells you that you're looking at an image on a screen. You're watching television. You're seeing a face, right? Mm-hmm. You're distinguishing between a shirt and somebody's arm or hair and that kind of thing.
So the So the five senses, to clarify for myself, are just receptors, and the brain is then taking those receptors and filing them under different categories and explaining them for you rapidly.
Exactly. So there's no such thing as a computer in the world or a sensation of a computer. There's you apply that structure to the sensation when you have it. So mm-hmm. it comes from you.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's Kant's great move, great Copernican revolution, is mm-hmm. he flips things around from previously all the people who were talking about sensation and all the empiricists, Locke, Berkeley, Hume, those guys, they thought everything was in sensation and human beings were just these blank tablets that got all this data pumped into them, and then they figured things out. I see one dog, I see two dogs, I see three dogs, I have an idea of dogs, right? Or dog, capital D.
Mm-hmm.
And Kant says, no, it's the other way around. You get all this sensation, you get all this sensation, but you yourself apply the categories because you have this structure in your consciousness that makes number and extension and time and all these things out of experience. So that's Kant's great big move, and that's a little bit of buildup, but the thing that Kant has to sacrifice and that really ate at him was, he says, the truth is, by virtue of doing this, because I know that you have the same consciousness that I do and you're experiencing the same sensations that I'm experiencing, we can agree that we're experiencing the same thing. So you and I can agree that we're having the same experience, but we still don't know anything about what causes the experience.
Mm-hmm.
Like, right. What is this bottle? What is this computer? I get these sensations, I shape it into a computer, but what's the computer? And that's the thing in itself.
Yeah.
It's really the same question of, how do I know the green that I see is the green that you see, to some extent, right? We're both.
That's part of the problem, exactly. Kant thinks he solved that particular piece of it. He mm-hmm. thinks we can say that we're seeing the same green, although our experience of it might be different. What he can't say is, what is the green thing in itself, meaning stripped of its properties.
I know what you mean. And that's the argument for science, right? To have a formula to explain green.
To have a formula to explain green and to find the laws that will consistently and repeatedly predict when something is green, that it has that same property, and when it has different properties, it's red.
And in doing that, we would say, okay, well, we can therefore trust that the brain is giving us the right information from the receptors. Otherwise, my brain might tell me that a bottle of water is a computer, right?
Yeah.
Wouldn't that just sort of be, I mean, I've always gotten the impression that philosophers would be content to chop, like if you, Danny, had that experience of looking at a water bottle and thinking it was a computer, I've always gotten the impression that most philosophers would be willing to chalk that up to a dysfunction if the vast majority of the people around you said, no, I'm sorry, that's actually a water bottle, then we would just say, oh, something's wrong with Danny's brain. He was in a car accident on Friday night, so that's what's going on.
Yeah.
Like, I've always gotten the impression that philosophers were okay with that move as long as there's a general consensus about things. I don't know. True, but...
So, I think they would, yes, most philosophers would say that. I also think that, speaking specifically about Kant or about this project, the idea would be, in addition to kind of social consensus, like that there would also be some measure of being able to say the physical laws of the world are such that you should experience this bottle of water as a bottle of water, and if you're not, then there's something wrong with you. And it's not just undergirded by the fact that we all agree that it's a bottle of water. It's also the fact that bottles of water are made of plastic and computers are made of metal and silicone, and there are all these physical shapes, and there are all sorts of physical laws and things that apply in this case that would make it so there's just no way you could mix up those categories. Now, if Danny had been raised to call computers water bottles from when he was a child and call water bottles computers, there would be no dysfunction, right?
Mm-hmm.
It would be the case that the categories that he brings to bear are the ones that he learned. I think Kant would probably say, you might have a different word for tree, but you and I better be talking about the same tree or you're broken.
It would still fit into his world as appearance kind of thing. It's just that my world as appearance was taught to me differently.
Yeah, although I think he would say certain things like, you couldn't possibly see two water bottles if there was only one. Like, that's not, you might be dysfunctional in a way where you see one thing as another.
Right.
But if you start losing track of time and number and extension, like if it looks two-dimensional to you instead of three,
right,
then there are serious problems.
So as long as the constructs of my mind are such that I'm seeing something, it doesn't matter how I interpret it, as long as I'm not creating things that aren't there, it's still a world of appearance.
Yes, or seeing things without the structures of consciousness that you should have, meaning space, time, extension, color. I mean, if you think about it, there's lots of mental disorders and diseases that people have where it causes memory loss, or they lose speech centers of the brain, or they, you know, go blind or deaf or whatever. But you've never heard of a mental disease that causes people to start seeing the world in two dimensions, or not experiencing time,
mm-hmm.
or not seeing objects as extended in space.
Yeah.
It's just the way we're made up.
I've actually thought about that before in regards to schizophrenia and like really, really serious problems with the brain. It suddenly struck me one time that we label people who have those kinds of disorders as being like almost like they're on the other side of some curtain or something from us, like they're experiencing something completely different than us. But if somebody comes up to you and they say something that sounds crazy, like my neighbor shot the green balloon and then it died or something, you still know all of those words. Like they didn't come up to you and speak in gobbledygook or start
right.
communicating with you using telepathy. Like they still used language and they still used the language that they heard while they were growing up. Like they still work remarkably well, actually, for human mm-hmm. beings. There was something, though, Seth, that something you just said made me think of. Oh, you were talking about Kant and science.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like there's something about Kant's maneuver that actually undermines science. So I found it sort of striking that you said he was trying to save science, or trying to come up with good philosophical grounds upon mm-hmm. which science could be done. Because to me, it feels like, I don't know, I guess I would have to ask more scientists about this, but it feels like saying to a scientist, you can measure things and you can put them on graphs and stuff, but I completely deny that you will ever access the thing in itself. I feel like a lot of scientists would have a problem with that. I don't know if I'm assuming too much about them or they, not.
They would have a problem with it, but they would be wrong to have a problem with it. it's true. Scientists presume that they're talking about the actual physical world and all that sort of thing. But the reality is that science is the undertaking of describing the regularities that exist in the physical world.
Yeah.
Without respect to what actually constitutes the objects that make up the physical world. Mm-hmm. If you do just you can just sort of Google this if you want and delve into a little bit. But the good scientists out there acknowledge that they don't have an answer for what and why. They don't know why the universe is, why is the gravitational constant what it is? Mm-hmm. Nobody knows, right? What are objects? So, well, when you get down to the level of matter and energy and all the kind of subatomic quantum stuff, I think it all gets very, very complicated. Mm-hmm. But they would not presume to say that they are answering questions of metaphysics, so to speak, or ontology. They're just saying, we're investigating the nature of the way the world works and figuring out how phenomena occur without saying specifically, we know what those phenomena are in their quote-unquote true selves, or, you know, they don't do ontology in that respect. They don't think of objects and particulars, and, you know, scientists don't strongly distinguish between universals and particulars.
Yeah.
They don't think in those terms, I don't think.
Do we have any scientists out there? Any scientists in the room? I feel like I'm hosting a comedy. Yes, sir, you're a scientist? And how's that going for you? You make a living? I don't know. I can't really... it's interesting to me. I can't really speak to... I don't know what scientists... I know what they would say. I don't have any scientist friends. If I do, closeted scientists. They don't tell me about it. You know, they're secretly practicing science.
We can... we can send this question to Dylan, since he technically speaking is a scientist.
Because it is a good question, and I'm wondering about it now. Like, how would a scientist feel about that? I wonder if you're right.
Well, I just think, I think if you look at what, for example, and when we say science, there's a lot of different sciences, right? Yeah. And we prototypically think of physics, but we've come to realize that physics, biology, chemistry all really boil down to mathematics, right? I mean, all of the regularities in all of those fields are ultimately mathematics. And I'm thinking about this in terms of this debate I'm doing on Wednesday on free will. And the guy I'm debating against has written a book, you know, basically saying quantum mechanics proves that we have free will because it allows... It allows for...
I love that argument.
Yeah, it couldn't possibly... It's very seductive, but it couldn't possibly be less correct. This... Basically, what we do when we do science is we try to find ways to express in mathematics the regularities. We try to describe the behavior of things in the world through mathematical expression. That's really what it is. And if you think about mathematics, it's a formula, and a formula is a set of constants, variables, and relationships between them. And so it's agnostic. Mathematics is agnostic as to what the variable is. It doesn't presume to tell you what a number is or what could go into that spot. It's just a formula that describes the behavior of that thing should you populate it with this or that. And that's what I meant when I said that science isn't really concerned with, like, what is a number? That's a really esoteric and difficult thing to try to plumb. And they're just like, we'll just take our numbers and go play with them.
Yeah. We talked a little bit about Schopenhauer's The Force.
We can try. You got to remind me what is that...
Well, you guys referred to it in the episode a few times, The Force.
The Force? So
I made a note when I was listening. Ask about The Force. Maybe that's just the Star Wars fan. I mean, find out about The Force.
I think Mark made a joke about it. Or he said something like, he feels The Force or something like that. But I thought it was just a joke.
No, I think he was trying to. Now I understand what you're saying. So yeah, that wasn't a Schopenhauer term. That was definitely a Marx term. But he's trying to make a point that Schopenhauer's description of the will is reminiscent of the way the force is described and works in the Star Wars movies. That it sort of is this weird, mysterious thing, that energy that fills the whole universe, and that some people are more in touch with, and some people are less in touch with. But it's responsible for. It's the way things are connected, if you will. I don't know what the right term is, but it's kind of like the, I'm trying to avoid using the term substance because that's another problematic thing that comes from the tradition. But so if you remember from, we'll go back, I think, well, you're probably both substantially younger than me, but you've obviously seen, yeah, I'm sorry, I can't get my camera working. You'd be able to see the gray in my beard.
In your photo, you don't even have a beard.
I know, it's terrible. So if you remember from the episode when Star Wars, the original one, not... the good one. I don't know what that... they have these second names now, like A New Hope and...
Yeah.
And I don't know which one's which. Anyway, Mark Hamill, you know, Harrison Ford, Carrie Fisher, that one. Mm-hmm. When the Empire blows up the Princess Leia's planet, and Obi-Wan tells Luke, I feel a great disturbance in the Force.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Even though he's miles away and removed from it, right? That's kind of, in a half-joking but half-serious way, what Mark was trying to get at. Because what Schopenhauer thinks is, he thinks he's solved the problem of the thing in itself that we were just talking about. And where Kant, the traditional view of what objects are, so I told you that Kant figured out appearance, right, and consciousness, and how do we bring those two things together.
Or he thought he did.
He thought he did. So he's still bedeviled by this idea of the thing in itself that somehow underlies these perceptions or appearances that we experience. And his idea of what that is still rooted in this tradition that goes all the way back to Aristotle of what we traditionally call substance ontology. So what does that mean? So you have a water bottle. The water bottle has extension. It's a certain height. It has a cap. It's a certain color. It has a certain feel. Let's say it's opaque. So let's say it's like one of those exercise water bottles that's not clear plastic, right? And perfect. Okay. So take away the opacity. So let's say you take away the opacity as a characteristic, as a property, right? Then let's say that it has a certain amount of weight. You say, okay, let's take away that weight, right? And since this has a certain kind of shape, take away the shape.
Cool.
Okay, now what's left? Like, if you take away all the things that all the properties that make that up, what's left behind it? What's left? Well, as far back, I mean, way, way, way back to Aristotle, he invented this idea of what he called substance. So the idea is the substance is this little metaphysical thing into which those properties stick. So we say, you know, say it's got this color and this shape, it weighs this much, it looks red, blah, blah, blah. Those are all the properties, and the properties, there's a lot of different terminology you'll hear in here, or, you know, whatever. The properties inhere in that substance. So what Kant was trying to do is say, okay, we've got all these appearances, and the appearances are provided by something. And I think in the back of his head, he has this idea that the world is, there's all these substances out there that are putting off these appearances, that have these properties that are putting them off. And what Schopenhauer is saying is, you're going about it all wrong. You think you're talking about something like substance, and that there's all these individual substances out there that are giving off appearances that we're experiencing. But reality is, what's behind all these appearances is just will. And it's that will, the same will that I experience when I have a sensation of myself as a willing being, as this unity that does things. And I see that in Tara, and Tara's a unity and a willing being. That's the same will that I have, she has, and the same will that we have, you have, Danny. Well, what Schopenhauer does is just say, well, listen, if I can say that about people, then I start going down the chain, and I start seeing that in other things as well. So first, animals. I see will in animals. They may not have the same self-consciousness. They may not have the same experience of their own unity and continuity in time like I do, but they certainly will to do things. And that's that same will. So he basically says there's this weird thing behind everything, the force, right, the will, and it comes through in me, and it comes through in you, and it comes through in my dog Rico Suave, and it comes through in the plants, the cacti and the plants we have. It comes through in the squirrels and the birds. And then he goes further, and he's like, it comes through in the stones. You know, he makes this argument, if you go through the whole, I don't know that we got all the way through, but he puts together this hierarchy of being, you know, starting with human beings on the top and then animals and plants and whatever. And he says, there's no real reason for thinking that some things have will and some things don't. Anything that's living has a will. It manifests will with a capital W. And so he in a weird way says, everything is an expression of this will that's manifesting itself in the world through us. So in one appearance, it's a water bottle. In another appearance, it's Tara. In a third appearance, it's a squirrel.
The will is also what connects us all in that case, because we all have the same will to interpret these substances the same way.
Well, even stronger than that. That's exactly right. But even stronger than that, there's just one will.
Yeah.
You and I have the same will. We are the same. We're expressions of the same will.
And whenever that will is there, there's always a way.
Well, there's always a representation.
So now that you're talking about the will manifesting itself, this leads me to one of the questions that came up as I was listening to the podcast. I wasn't clear if you guys were saying that Schopenhauer didn't get to this explanation, or maybe you guys did deal with it and I just didn't understand it. But the talking about, it seemed to me that there was a problem with talking about the relationship between will and representation without using causal language.
Mm-hmm.
And so the term that kept coming up, I love the word manifest. It's a beautiful word.
Right.
But it also felt like that the question of what Schopenhauer is saying the relationship between those two things is was not clear, to me at least, how that relationship is explained without using causal language, when manifest kind of felt like code for causation trying to not use the word causation. Does that make sense?
No, it makes perfect sense, and you hit the nail on the head. So Schopenhauer does try to address this, but you're expressing the same question that you can use this question 1,000 times in the history of philosophy.
Okay.
So how does the idea of a horse for Plato, the form of the horse, cause or have a causal connection to an actual horse?
Mm-hmm.
How does a universal, the idea of, you know, horse, what a love, whatever, have an actual causal force on what happens in the world? How do mental states, how does your conscious mind, how does your will force the body or will your body and have a causal relationship that makes you stand up and get a drink of water or do whatever?
Right.
And it's the same problem of basically what you might call the non-physical and the physical. So whether it's mental states in your brain, like, you know, or ideas versus objects in the world, he can't explain it. And in fact, he kind of glosses it towards the end of the second book, where, you know, he says he's working backwards, and he basically says, he's doing inference here. He's saying, because I experience this myself, and I see other people that strongly show me evidence that they experience it as well,
mm-hmm.
I have to assume that they are expressing the same will or expressions of the same will. They have the same lived experience, if you will, that I'm having. Mm-hmm. And then you just keep going down that path. Okay, well, what's the draw line where we say, are we different than animals? No, not really, blah, blah, blah. And he gives some very, very, I would say, almost poetic language around, for example, when he's talking about plants and how mm-hmm. he gets very detailed about talking about inclination or intuition versus actual will. So, for mm-hmm. example, plants strive, but the striving doesn't have a conscious point because they don't think and reason. Mm-hmm. So we strive, but when we strive and we put our conscious, reasonable mind to it, it becomes intention. So plants strive, but they don't intend, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. That's how...
Whoa. What about those ones, the fly trap ones? What are those called?
Still reaction, unfortunately.
Yeah.
But, you know, you think about like an acorn that becomes a tree. The acorn already has in it a will or a striving to become a tree, but not with any conscious awareness of that as being its goal, which I thought was really kind of clever and cute. But anyway, he gets to the point where he says, we don't know why the will makes me like me and something else like a tree and something else like a dog and something else like the ocean. It's just the will is kind of the motive force that drives the creation of beings and being.
So the will is God?
You know what? There's a lot of people that read it that way. But if you do, because I'm a manifestation of the will and the will underwrites everything, you're reading God as what we call immanent.
Yeah.
Like Spinoza did, which mm-hmm. is to say God is in everything mm-hmm. and we're all God. Mm-hmm. And that's not something that most of the monotheistic religions are going to be comfortable with. That's much more of a naturalistic thing. So there's no way Schopenhauer would certainly have not thought that the will was God in the sense being in the environment that he was in, and he was very hostile to the religious people around him at the time. Mm-hmm. But you can think of will, Heidegger's being that comes later on, if you read any Heidegger, and if you haven't, that makes sense. I think Spinoza definitely is an influence here.
Sounds a lot like him.
Yeah, I think it's that sort of thing. I think even then, Schopenhauer would resist reading this in that naturalist vein, only because, bless you.
Thank you.
Only because I think he's trying to do something bigger and broader with this, and he is, you know, ultimately at the end of this entire book, right? He does book one is representation, book two is the will, and then he ends up he does one more book on ethics, and then the other one's on aesthetics.
Mm-hmm.
And Spinoza did the same thing. He did his big metaphysical project. He wrote the ethics, which is basically a long extended proof, that we're all one substance, going back to that substance ontology. That God is that substance and we're all aspects of God, blah, blah, blah. And then he does the ethics. He talks about the ethical implications. He doesn't do aesthetics, but I think Schopenhauer was trying to do something similar with a broader, more modern vocabulary and without the baggage, the medieval baggage that Spinoza brought with him.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting. Is it Tara Lay?
Tara Lee. Yeah.
Tara Lee.
Yeah.
I like how you like the word manifest. I like the way you're like, it's a lovely word, manifest.
It's a beautiful word. It is. I'm a poet. It's a great word.
It's one of those words that it's got greatness in it, but you know, you surround it with other words and it loses it. Like destiny. You add that to it. Suddenly, it's not meeting up to its potential anymore as a word. But I love when people get excited about certain words in the English
language. Yeah, all right. I get excited about a lot of words.
That's a dying breed.
Yeah.
Schopenhauer is pre-Nietzsche and Heidegger, right? Yeah, Heidegger's 20th century.
Yes, Heidegger's 20th century.
Yeah.
Nietzsche's 19th century. Okay. Schopenhauer's a little before. Schopenhauer had a huge influence on Nietzsche.
Yeah, I could see that. I could definitely see that.
Because, you know, Nietzsche's going to write a lot about the will.
Yeah.
And while he's not doing the same project as Schopenhauer, he definitely takes a lot from him.
Yeah. Well, I feel like, I don't know where in Nietzsche's career he wrote this, but his wonderful ode to Wagner, the one about the Apollonian and the Dionysian, mm-hmm. I felt like the idea of, like, individual representations of this big will felt like it actually related very nicely to I guess the will would sort of correspond to the Dionysian and the representation would sort of correspond to the Apollonian. Mm.
Can you tell me about that? Because I don't know about the Apollonian and the Dionysian.
Nietzsche had this idea of, it's been so long since I read it. Dionysus is like the god of wine, and all of the cultic celebrations around Dionysus were totally wild. Like, you know, everybody's getting drunk, and who knows exactly what substances were being consumed, and there was strange
mead.
Sacrifices.
Probably
and
some mead.
Some mead, yes. Mead is excellent. You know, sacrifices and probably lots of weird sexual stuff that we would think of as just kind of like orgies. And it sort of, the way Nietzsche interprets it anyway, is it represents sort of the dissolution, D-I-S-S-O-L, of the individual into like the primordial beingness, like the big blob that we all come out of. And the Apollonian, Apollo. And I didn't even totally understand why he associated Apollo with this, other than Apollo is associated with sculpture. But Apollo he represents individuation. So when you have an experience of yourself, which a lot of us do most of the time, you go through the world and you experience yourself as an individual who has borders, like you end a certain place and other people begin in another place. That's an Apollonian... Apollonian would describe that experience of individuation and differentiation between you and others.
That's if you've been to enough therapists and they tell you, you end here and they begin there.
Yes, yes, yes. Yes, some of us have to go to a lot of therapy to learn that. And then the Dionysian, though, is like this almost spiritual experience of annihilation of the self in this greater... I think primordial is really the best word, like this I don't want to say pre-time, because of course that's a stupid phrase, but...
Nick, can I add some color to that?
Yeah, go for it, then
The other part, another aspect of it, it works on a lot of different layers, but the Dionysian is also rural, so it's pastoral, rather, it's nature, so mm-hmm. it's associated with your drives, that... your sex drive, your drive to create your physical body. Mm-hmm. Apollo is the god of the city. He's the god of the polis.
Mm-hmm.
And the polis is, of course...
The way Irish people pronounce police.
I don't know. Polis. maybe Scotsman. Hey.
I'm calling the polis.
But it's more about society and rules and order and structure, you know. So you want to maintain the integrity of the polis, mm-hmm. of the social order. Whereas in the Dionysian, the social order completely disintegrates, just in the way that Tara was describing. Mm. So we're actually we have on the docket to do Nietzsche's Birth of Tragedy, which is where he talks about this.
Yes.
Maybe by the end of the summer. So it's on the list, but we've got a bunch of other things to do. And so, yeah, this is... I think you're right in thinking that Nietzsche associated... What Nietzsche did was personalize, I think, Schopenhauer's version of the will. It mm-hmm. becomes this... It's not an abstract metaphysical thing for him. It becomes... Can you... capture that Dionysian aspect of yourself, overcome all the social mores, what Freud called the superego, right? I know what your parents taught you, what people expect of you, and can you use your will to manifest this person who you should be that is creative and beautiful and strong and, you know, all those things that he admired and all those characters that he admired. Mm-hmm. And so I think his idea is that the Dionysian is the thing that we've lost as we've become more civilized. And he, mm-hmm. of course, blames that on Christianity, which means he blames it on the Jews, that, that ever since monotheism came into play, we've just been successfully crushing our, mm-hmm. you know, all those urges that make us who we are, and that it's going to take a special person to come and get all those things out and let them loose again.
Like a messiah?
Well, yeah. He used a different word, but yes.
The dirty messiah. He's going to come and get everybody riled up again.
Yeah, it's he thought Wagner was doing something like this because he was going back to those primordial Aryan myths that were pre-Christian. Mm-hmm. But his, you know, his name for it is the Übermensch, as opposed to the messiah. It's,
right.
So.
Still a Jew. Mensch.
That's right. Nothing like a little Yiddishkeit in your philosophy.
It must have been the most disappointing will when Schopenhauer died, and people were like, "Oh, what did he leave me in the will?" Well, he just talked about the self.
And, what did he leave you in the will?
He talked about what the will dictates is really basically how you interpret the world. Well, what did he leave me? Well, he just left you with a bunch of knowledge about basically how the will is what's interpreting what's coming in from the senses. Yeah, okay, but did he leave me any money?
Yeah. Schopenhauer. Yeah.
Schopenhauer's disappointing will. That's a sketch for philosophy nerds.
There you go. Yeah. That'll play to the world's smallest audience.
I'm good at cracking up one person in Portland. So where does this leave us? How are we feeling about everything here?
Well, do we have more questions?
I have a quick sort of a logistical question. I was confused about, there was discussion of, like, there were different volumes and different books and different sections, and I was confused about what you guys were actually discussing in this podcast.
Got it. So let me tell you specifically, give me 2 seconds here.
And I have a question to add on to that question. What made you guys decide to focus on that specific piece?
Hmm. Okay, so there are, so that what we read specifically was technically speaking book 2.
Okay, of volume 1, which is the original.
Yes, there's,
okay.
Yes. Yeah, there are, I think, several volumes, and the different volumes contain different books, mm-hmm. and we specifically read book 2. So the reason, the books are ordered in this way. Book 1 is on representation. Book 2 is on the will. Book 3 is on ethics or aesthetics. And book 4 is on ethics and aesthetics are books 3 and 4. I don't remember which order they're in.
Okay.
So we figure we know enough about representation after 20-some-odd years of studying philosophy that we didn't need to read book 1 to have him tell us, you know, I'm using Kant's notion of representation. We were like, okay, we can, although it's worth, there are parts of it that are worth reading. I skimmed it anyway. Book 2 is about the will, which is his unique contribution and criticism of Kant, etc. So that's why we read that. But the other guys read the book on aesthetics, mm-hmm. and that's where they had the conversation. The next episode that comes out mm-hmm. is an episode on the aesthetics with Jonathan Siegel, who is the violinist for Camper Van Beethoven.
Oh, cool.
The violinist for what?
Camper Van Beethoven.
Camper Van Beethoven.
You never heard of them? They're an 80s band. I guess they're still around.
Okay.
They're one of Mark. It's like one of Mark's heroes. He loves Camper Van Beethoven and XTC. They, again, I told you I was older than you. If you want to get satellite radio.
I was alive in the 80s.
I'm sure you were. had you gone through the mirror stage at that point yet?
Early in the 80s, I did.
Okay. yeah, so Mark has been trying to get Partridge, the guy from XTC, I think his name's Alan Partridge, I can't remember, to come on the show. And he'd been tweeting at Camper Van Beethoven and a couple of other, like King Crimson and, you know, some of those bands. And so anyway, yeah, so they're covering the aesthetics. I don't think we're going to cover his ethics this time around. I don't know. Very few people read Schopenhauer on ethics. So maybe 10 years from now we'll get back to it. Because I don't think there was any, he had much to add. He didn't do the same kind of strong critique of Kant. Kant has a lot more to say about it, and the part of the Schopenhauer's ethics in this world as will and representation isn't the same detailed level response to Kant, nor is it anything new and interesting, I think, in general. I think he just tries to explain the implications for ethics of accepting his idea of the will, which should be fairly obvious, right? I mean,
it's hard to accept his idea of the will when you look at it.
No, it's very difficult. It's a beautiful idea, and you can imagine that this is the kind of thing. What did we read recently? I can't remember. We had something where it was also talking about the interconnectedness of things and how that had been adopted by, you know, environmental groups and hippies and theologians, modern day theologians, all that stuff about. Ricoeur, I think.
Uh-huh.
I think we were talking about the theologians that had adopted the hermeneutic stuff. So when we were reading Gadamer, we were talking about Paul Tillich, and you know, that these kinds of things have been adopted by people who want to point out the interconnectedness and sameness of things and use that as a basis for an ethical system that would drive public policies, you know, around the environment, for example. Well, aside from Schopenhauer, do you guys have questions or interests or anything like that, or about other philosophy, stuff that we do, me in particular?
Tara, let me do a check-in on the knitting real quick. Where are we at with that?
You know, I actually set it down because I have a very hard time following intellectual conversation while I'm knitting. I think it goes into parts of my brain or something. When I'm knitting, I kind of go into same part of my brain that's active when I'm holding a baby or something.
Yeah, you said no problem. I'm gonna knit through it up top, but it turned out. I was like, let me see how she's gonna do that. That's pretty cool. Multitasking.
Yep, can't do it.
It's all right.
Seth. I wanted to ask, actually, this may be going back a little bit. So the term representation, which was some long German word, is that something that you were saying Kant brought up, or that was like part of his,
he's using it in the same way that Kant does.
Okay.
So it's like appearance. Representation is just same thing as appearance.
Okay.
For all intents and purposes.
Okay. I think I might actually like that better. That word better.
How many philosophers have great works? I mean, there's got to be millions, but how many of the philosophers who are major key players' works revolve around refuting what Kant said? it seems like quite a number of them from my research on modern day philosophers. It's almost every one of them is refuting it's all. Kant seems to be at this epicenter of all of it.
Well, he's certainly one of them. So, Alfred Lord North Whitehead is famous for having said something to the effect of, "The history of philosophy is a series of footnotes to Plato." Mm-hmm. And what he meant by that was Plato defined the terms of the conversation so extensively and so forcefully that for 2,000 years, everybody was using was either speaking like him or responding to him, mm-hmm. including Aristotle, FYI, mm-hmm. although Aristotle brought other elements to bear. And in that same way, Kant is the next major figure in the history of philosophy to become like that. He wrote on every subject. He had a complete systematic approach to solve all the problems, you know, basically pretty much all the problems of philosophy. He solved, you know, he had a metaphysics, he had an epistemology, he had an aesthetics, he brought in the notion of, you know, he talked about consciousness and modernized the notion of human experience from what Plato had done. And so he becomes the new Plato when he writes. Now, there's some other guys at the time. Hegel is another huge player at the time, but Hegel is just a very different kind of thinker. And so Kant changes the terms of the conversation to such an extent, and he has such notoriety when he's writing, that you have to kind of start engaging him. But also, as I said, you know, he kind of quote-unquote solved that problem of epistemology, and so the structure and the language that he comes up with, people have to start using. Now, he doesn't have as long of a shelf life as Plato did for a couple of reasons. One is Plato is writing right before there's such massive shifts in the nature of Western culture where there's not, I'm trying to think of how to say this, after the Greek civilization sort of dissolves or falls apart and you have the Romanization and the Christianization, there are no great thinkers. And what I mean by that is the Romans were not a culture of intellectual, it wasn't their thing.
No, it wasn't.
So they adopted all of the older thinkers and they just kind of Romanized them. And then the Romans get Christianized, and the Christian thinkers inherit that. Now, there's a lot of interesting stuff going on in other parts of the world, but with respect to what we call the Western tradition, all of the medieval philosophers, so Augustine and Aquinas and all those guys, they're sitting there, and they've got Plato, who's the great philosopher. They have Jesus, and they've got Aristotle, who brings sort of elements of science, and they're trying to figure out, how do I bring these three guys together? So a huge part of the project of what's called scholasticism, which is basically, mm-hmm. you know, the Middle Ages, is to try to reconcile, you know, Christ and Plato. Mm-hmm. And it takes a long time for philosophers to try to break free of that tradition and think critically in a non-religious way. And Descartes is sort of the very first major figure in that vein. Descartes really only has one trick, but it's a very good trick. You know, he's like the hedgehog. And he kicks off the discussion. He makes possible what comes after him, which is the English guys, you know, Hume, the empiricist and the skeptics, and who in turn make possible Kant. And then after Kant, you're talking like Kant, you're trying to figure out, well, how to solve the stuff that he left unsolved, you're complaining about him until the 20th century, when you kind of start to see a divergence along the lines of people coming out of Nietzsche and Kierkegaard and doing more of that existential kind of stuff, which wasn't trying to solve epistemology anymore. The phenomenologists were. So if you
and they did so them, phenomenally, I might add.
Right, I'm trying to think of a way to work in manifest. Phenomenally manifest. Yeah, they're still worried about epistemology, which means they have to deal with the Kantian stuff and consciousness and the transcendental ego and all that sort of thing. but everything that splinters off of that, they don't need it anymore. And of course, the analytic guys started just talking about sentence structure. The cat is on the mat.
Yep.
How do we know that the proposition that the cat is on the mat is true? Because the state of affairs that there's a cat on the mat obtains. There's another magic word for you. Obtain.
Yeah. This is from the philosophy book of Dr. Seuss, The Cat on the Mat.
Some of these essays, Danny, some of the stuff written by these guys in like the 50s and 60s reads like Dr. Seuss. To me. I think it has less significance, but I'll leave that editorialization around.
The cat on the mat just sat. How long did the cat on the mat sit? I don't know.
How do we know that the cat in the hat, how do we know that the Grinch stole Christmas is true? The proposition that the Grinch stole Christmas is true.
Well, we have to first define what Christmas is. Is it just a construct of our imaginations, or is it an actual metaphysical thing?
But the Grinch is a fictional character. How can we make true or false statements about a fictional character that doesn't exist in the world?
It depends if Christmas is a fictional holiday or not.
What did that just remind me of? This just reminded me of something that was in you guys' discussion. So I'm reading Parmenides right now, and as you guys were talking about it, I was thinking about Parmenides.
Parmenides, I remember that.
That was a lot of groaning right there.
It's difficult.
I'm making myself get through it, but I am not enjoying it. But then somebody actually quoted something from the Schopenhauer piece, and I wasn't clear on if it was from, because I'm reading Plato's Parmenides, and then I know Parmenides wrote his own philosophical.
There's some fragments, yeah.
Yeah. What, do you know if that quote was from Parmenides' actual pieces, or was that from Plato?
I don't recall specifically, but my brain is telling me that Mark was talking about Parmenides, the guy, in general, and not the Platonic dialogue.
Okay.
But I won't swear to that.
Okay.
And he's just in the same way we were talking about immanence and the will kind of undergirding everything.
I think
that was the reference he was trying to make, because Parmenides says everything is one. So Parmenides says everything is one, and then he has to explain how change happens.
Mm-hmm.
And Heraclitus says everything is change.
Mm-hmm.
Then he has to explain how things can appear to persist through time.
Right, yeah.
Those are the two ends of the spectrum, and I think we were just trying to say that Schopenhauer, the will feels more Parmenidean than Heraclitean.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, that makes sense.
It just occurred to me that Platonic friendship is obviously based on Plato, right?
Yeah, I think it comes from the idea, because it's funny, because I don't think that Plato was terribly Platonic, but Socrates, you know, was, I don't know, this is my understanding of it, because I spent too long studying sexuality in ancient Greece, but Socrates...
Hey, who hasn't, you know? Wink, wink.
Socrates was, you know, he was part of this environment where, like, the aristocratic men had older men had sexual relationships with younger men, and he, in Plato's dialogues anyway, who knows about the real person, but he appears to form very close relationships and friendships with these young men who are interested in philosophy, but to stop short of ever actually having sex with any of them. In the symposium, I remember, like, you know, Alcibiades is, like, talking about the fact that he won't consummate any kind of relationship between them. So I think that when people talk about, like, Platonic love and Platonic friendships, they're talking about that, like the ideal of being able to be super close to someone without ever actually being sexually intimate with them. I think that's where that comes from.
Stands to reason. Makes sense.
Yeah.
As good an explanation as any. Although Socrates, if I remember correctly, who is it? He's being pursued, but he's refusing. Or is he doing the pursuing? Yes.
Yeah.
In the symposium, he's being pursued and he's refusing.
Yes. Yep. Yeah. Yeah. He I Plato, though, I think. I don't know why it ended up being called platonic love, because Plato actually was, I think, what we would call gay. He had a long-term partner.
There might have been something. It might be something about the way he talks about it in the Republic, but I can't remember. I should just.
Maybe.
No. I like how you lit up for a maybe. maybe.
Yeah. No, I could see that.
Well, Wikipedia says it's from the Symposium, so.
Okay, yeah, the way.
So that must be true.
Oh, Wikipedia.
I was looking at the top ranked websites. I think Wikipedia is like number 3.
Yeah.
And in like it beats Amazon and a bunch of others.
Really?
Which is pretty interesting. You can't get phone chargers for 99 cents on Wikipedia. I'm pretty sure. Yeah. How are they competing with that? I don't understand. Seth, you're the tech guy. Explain this.
All I can say is that I also did not go to Wikipedia to buy my gas lantern mantles. Recently.
Yeah. Glass lantern mantles. Yeah, I'm trying to figure that one out too. You for camping?
No, my neighbor is we live next to a very old couple, and they've been here for 40 years in this house, and the house has a gas lantern out in the yard that has been on for 40 years because they didn't know how to turn it off. And it apparently has the same mantles, which are the little things that look like netting that glow. The things that actually glow are called mantles. And apparently it's had the same ones in there for 30 years or however long. And he tells the guy who takes care of his yard not to hit the post with a lawnmower or anything like that because you have to be really careful. And so this thing has been burning literally for 30 years or 40 years. And, you know, the glass is all clouded up and it's hot as, you know. But I thought, God, this is just ridiculous. Why even bother to have it? But then power went out in the neighborhood, and the only thing that was lit, the only light on the street, was this gas lantern. We had a vicious storm here a couple of weeks. So I made the commitment that I was going to figure out how to replace those mantles and clean the glass and rehabilitate his, so he wouldn't have to worry about bumping it with a lawnmower. And it turns out, you know, it's a $6.50 solution, but. So,
good for you.
Yeah, I bought some. So I'm waiting for them to come home from wherever they are, so I can triumphantly leap across the lawn and say, "I am here to fix your gas lantern."
Maybe you have to fix the lantern in order for them to come home. It might be like a light tower for a ship.
Well, I also have to fix the lantern if I have any expectation of finding an honest man in Highland Hills. I'm trying to throw out some old Greek and references for Tara since she
I didn't get it, but I
I only sort of like got it sideways. I can't remember exactly where that comes from, but
Diogenes the Cynic.
Is that who it, Yeah. I haven't actually read the Cynics yet, but
he claims to anecdote of him running through the town with a lantern, and somebody says, "What are you looking for?" And he says, "An honest man."
Honest man, yeah.
Yes. One of my friends hosts a podcast. I'll give him a plug, called Skeptically Yours, and it's a big podcast for skeptics. So I went to his girlfriend's birthday party with my fiance Kylie, and I was like, "So who are all these people introduced me around?" Are any of them also comedians? He goes, "Well, we had some comedians here earlier, but no, most of them are skeptics." And I was like, I don't believe you.
Yeah.
They're all skeptics, all of them? Well, that one's a cynic. That one's a skeptic. And that one is scenic. I don't know. But that one's just scenic. He just likes the fall. But I just thought it was pretty cool to be hanging out with a bunch of skeptics. I was like, hey, none of them really even think I'm here, you know? They don't even really believe it's me.
Were they those kind of skeptics, or were they Sam Harris kind of skeptics?
No, I just kid around about it. But in my mind, they're all like, hey, is that Daniel Bell? I highly doubt it.
That actually, I don't usually hang out with skeptics because I'm religious and I don't always feel like I'm welcome. But I would love to go to a skeptics party where it was like that, where they were like, oh, I'm Tara Lee, where I said like, oh, I'm Tara Lee, and they were like, oh. That sounds like a fun party, actually.
You know, like, they all know that I'm a God believer because I go on the show and we have conversations about it. Mm-hmm. And they're all super cool to me. So,
nice.
I mean, I think, you know, I don't know. I definitely can understand your reservations and hesitations, but they were all pretty chill people. I liked them, you know. They're just all skeptical, you know. They just...
Yeah, that's nice.
But, yeah, they're good people. Most people are good people. Actually, like I was saying before, I don't think anybody's really a good or bad person. I think people are just, you know, people, neutral. And for the most part, they do good things.
I reserve the right to label men's rights activists as bad people.
Who's taking the reservations? I reserve the right. Well, you're talking to the wrong guy. I don't take reservations. I love that. There's no reserving any rights. I mean, and there's no rights, but that's okay.
Yeah.
men's rights activists, is that what you said?
Yeah, they're a thing. They're a thing. Mostly I encounter them online. Less now because I've just given up altogether having discussions on online forums, which has done a lot to save my sanity. But yeah, men's rights activism is sort of a...
What are they fighting for? We have the right to make more money than women.
I think, you know, it gets a little confusing sometimes to me even, but some of the things they definitely argue that ideas like I think they would go so far as to say that patriarchy either isn't real or it isn't really a problem anymore. They definitely deny the existence of rape culture. And they tend to have pet issues. Like, I've noticed that one of the things they get really riled up about is concerns about child protective services taking children away from homes. They think that organizations like Child Protective Services and governmental organizations that are supposed to help families end up really grossly favoring women. And they cite all these examples, which upon further study, which many journalists have actually bothered to study their claims, don't tend to hold up, that all these men who are perfectly good men, who are perfectly good fathers, have had their children taken away from them simply because they're men, because society is sexist in favor of women and against men.
It sounds like a bunch of guys who basically feel like they got shafted in some way on their own personal thing, and they're looking for a support group or someone
yes.
to tell them,
yeah.
someone to say, you know what, it wasn't your fault that you lost your kids, man. You were a great dad.
Yeah.
And where else are they going to go except a bunch of other people who have had shitty circumstances online, and they can all get together and kind of hug each other on some forum and say, it's all right, man, your kids are still going to respect you.
It's her, man. Yeah. It feels like it is a movement that is definitely almost created by the internet, because I feel like, I think you're right, I think like there's a lot of things like that. Because
no guys are going to drive to like a church basement to do that.
It's actually, now they do.
Do they really?
No, there's like conventions. Yeah, yeah. There's now like men's rights activist conventions.
Really? Oh
yeah.
My God. Did the Daily Show do anything on that yet?
I don't know. They should.
Yeah. That's just really just a bunch of divorced guys who don't want to go for therapy.
Yeah, well,
I don't know. I got to look into it more. I'm just going off what you said, but now yeah, I'm intrigued.
A lot of them are probably individuals who are genuinely scarred, and I think that they...
I think
that they actually bring up issues that feminism probably should deal with and hasn't done a good enough job dealing with, but when I encounter them online, I run the other way.
I would argue that they're all scarred, because I don't think there's a happy guy in the world who also wants to go on a men's rights forum. I just can't. It just doesn't register. Like, everything has gone great for me in my relationship. But you know what? I feel like sympathizing with a bunch of guys that, you know, feel victimized by women. It's just, they're all scarred. There's no other explanation for it, right? They have to have all had negative encounters with women and felt like they got the raw end of the deal. And there's no guy who's happily married, loves his wife and loves his relationship, and also jumps on those forums at night to get in on the party. I can't imagine that.
There's probably something to that, but I think that one could say there aren't a lot of happily married men in a lot of arenas of life, and we still take them seriously, so...
right, well...
I don't know if we should take them so seriously, but...
All right, guys. all right, well... Thank you for tuning in.
Yes. I was your one citizen who participated.
But you brought the presence of 100 citizens.
Yes. You know, on a serious note related to that, so the last one of these I did, we had like 10 people, of mm-hmm. which maybe 5 participated. Weird. Is this a thing? Like, Danny's obviously... he's not on the top of his game today, but he wants to be a part of this. We're trying to find ways to get people more engaged. Mm-hmm. What did we do? What do we need to do better to make people want to show up to this thing, or to make them aware of it, or what is it about it that?
I don't know. I mean, I think that the technical confusions today may have contributed to it, because I know that there were earlier at least. I know at least one other person logged in briefly, and I think I saw one other person. Yeah, I think 2 other people logged in and maybe left because they were, I don't know, maybe they left because they thought, oh, okay, I guess it's not happening or something. Mm. I don't know, though. I was a little surprised that more people didn't log in today, because I know that at least a couple of them were on the Google group that I was on last week, and they... were very engaged and seemed very into it.
I know I posted on my Facebook, and I have one person saying they tried to do it, but they were asked to install something. I'm not sure. They said they'll be here next time.
Okay. Yeah. I don't know. I don't know if I'm a good person.
Barriers are.
I don't know if I'm a good person to ask, because to me, this seems like a great opportunity to talk to people about intellectual things, but that's because I don't have anyone in my real life that I can talk to about intellectual things. So maybe everybody else has lots of intellectual discussion in their life.
Maybe. Well, at least it's got to at least beat the men's rights forums, right?
Yeah. I don't know. That's a good question, though. Have you, when you said that you were on one, and there were 10 and 5%. Did you mean 10 signed up to participate, but only 5 actually did?
No, I mean there were, at one point, there were as many as 10 people on the Google Hangout.
Oh! Okay.
Maybe 8, but it was definitely, there. People would pop, same as this, people popped in and out, but there were like kind of 4 diehards that hung through the whole thing.
Yeah.
Now, what was the subject of that? What were we talking about? Oh my gosh, I've forgotten which one. What I do know is that several of the people had very strong opinions and had done a lot of research on that particular topic, and I ended up not talking at all.
Was it the Jesus After Show?
Like, no. Okay. This was earlier this year. It was, oh, God. They went off on aesthetics. But that wasn't what we talked about.
Mm-hmm.
Hold on. Now I'm upset that I can't remember what this is. Hold on a second. I got to find out. I was on the frickin' recording. I should know. I think it was Gadamer.
Okay. Huh.
That must have been it.
I had a bit of difficulty. Well, for one thing, I hate to use excuses, but I really am not on the ball today. And rightfully so. I'll give myself that. But I had a little bit of difficulty getting the thing up and running. It's also my first time. Excuses, no, I know. No. I know. Excuses. But I had a good time doing it. I enjoyed it, and I thought it was an interesting talk. So
yeah.
I hope it continues.
Oh, I think we will. I think we just want to figure out how to make it more effective and more and easier. Like we're putting it on you. Like we had Stephen West, and now we're asking Danny, just because mm-hmm. with all the other things that we do, it's just like too much for us to more than one of us to yeah. participate.
Yeah.
But this is the thing. Google Hangouts, this is supposed to be easy. And what mm-hmm. we're finding is it's not. Like, it's supposed to be really easy to set one of these up. It's supposed to be really easy to send it out to people. And
yeah.
so,
it was a little confusing because the first one didn't yeah. broadcast. I mean,
I haven't had one of these, Danny, where I didn't have a problem.
Oh, yeah. Interesting. Okay.
Of one for one, you know, one reason or another. And people have the same issues. When there's more people on, this is the other thing. Like, I noticed that Danny and I are both using, you can't see me, but I have cans on and a mic with a spit guard in front of me. So
okay.
But people will log in and use their computer mic and speakers
mm-hmm.
and we get feedback. So we'll start hearing these echoes because uh-huh. as I speak through your computer speakers, your microphone picks it up.
Uh-huh.
And so we were trying to explain to people you need to have a pair of headphones on, even earbuds, but we can even hear it through that. And for whatever reason, your rig is really good. But
at this point, it's only partially examined technology.
Yeah. Well, totally. And so I'm on this call. There's like 8 people on there. I'm asking people to go on mute because we're starting to get these feedback loops going that are starting to and then, you know, the cameras, people are walking in through the back. And as this woman comes in and he's like, Mom, I'm on the call with somebody. And she's like, what? Who? You know, and she leans over and looks in the camera, and I'm like, hi, Mrs. Weissengruber. You know, she's like, you know, it just, and then his little sister comes in and is bugging him, you know. I mean, it was just, so, anyway, it can be kind of out of control. But we're trying to find a way, hopefully we can get some kind of, like, technology where we could have a calendar, people could sign up, and there would be easy reminders and things like that, you know, that would make it.
Mm-hmm.
But,
Yeah. Well, I like it.
Thanks.
I have to go now, but it was fun.
Likewise. So. Thanks for joining.
Yeah.
Share your poetry.
Thank you.
Thanks, Seth. Thanks for all the...
thanks, Danny.
Thank you.
I'm going to check in with you later this week and see how you're doing.
Thank you. I appreciate it. I learned a lot. I appreciate
okay.
it. This
was good. No, thanks. I'm looking forward to being out in LA again. We're going to have to hang out.
Yeah, this was a rough few days for me.
So,
Friday. Yeah.
Is it general stuff or do you have a specific, like, are you anything broken or?
The doctor at the ER last night said it's just whiplash and that my muscles are inflamed. So that's good.
Okay.
But it still hurts.
Yeah, no shit. So you're engaged?
I'm engaged, man.
Did that happen from the last time we talked to you?
It did, yeah.
Yeah, congratulations.
Thank you. So I'm a soon-to-be married man. Should I stop the broadcast? Or should I guess this is all part of it.
Yeah, no. It's up to you. You're a public figure, so, you know.
Yeah. It's all public information.
Good. Well, congratulations. When's the date?
In July, end of July.
All right. So is it going to be like a big family thing?
It'll be, I don't know, big, but, you know, family will be there, hopefully.
I mean, does she have a big family? Do you have a big family?
No, my family's not that big, and her family's pretty small. So.
Okay.
So it'll be a medium family thing combined.
Medium family thing. But you got 1,000 friends there too. It's always the dilemma of paring down the list. Get ready for that if you haven't already done it.
I've already done it. And you have to sit there and decide, is that person really a friend?
That's right. Did they invite me to their wedding? Mm-hmm. Do I have a relationship with their children? Yeah.
All right. Good. Cool, man. Well, thanks again.
Thank you. Take care, and I'll check in with you later.
Cool. Thank you.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye.